1983, and this is the 10 o'clock study on Thursday morning. Now, we closed our study last night with some consideration for the fact that Christ was directed of his Father to make a very special trip to Canaan, all the way down from the Jerusalem area, or the Jericho-Jordan area, and he returned to Canaan to be present at this marriage feast, which we'll see much more later. But first of all, I want to establish the point that marriage is an extremely important element in the work of the gospel. And to lift our eyes above marriage merely as a human ordinance, to see it as a picture of the divine relationship between God and his people, and also as a picture between the relationship that God has sustained toward the angels for the ministry of Jesus Christ up in heaven. Last night we read from Great Controversy, page 427, in respect to a future marriage between Christ and the New Jerusalem, the New Jerusalem being the bride. And it holds this position by virtue of the fact that it is the capital of the glorious kingdom that Christ will build as a result of his ministry down here upon this earth. I want now to list four or five, maybe six reasons, I just forgot the exact number, four or five reasons why a marriage between Christ and humanity was absolutely essential for the completion of the restoration of the lost kingdom. But now, first of all, I'd like to just remind ourselves of Daniel chapter 2. I'll draw here the crudest of all image drawings ever seen. And there was the head of gold, breast, arms of silver, belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron, feet of iron and clay. And in the book of Daniel, there are two great mountains. First of all, there's the mountain from which the stone is cut, as you remember. And that stone then strikes the image upon the feet of it and grinds the image to powder. And then that stone itself grows into another great mountain or kingdom. Now, the point I should be making is this, that Jesus Christ utterly emptied himself of his position. He gave up the kingdom totally, completely, and came down to this earth as a destitute wanderer, a poverty-stricken man ministering to all the needs of humanity. And through this connection with humanity, he grows to become a great mountain which fills the entire world. And this, of course, is his marriage or repossession of the lost kingdom. He wins back that which he lost, or gave up, I should better say, by virtue of the marriage relationship formed between himself and humanity. And we'll look at quite a number of reasons now as to why that marriage is a very essential element in the program of salvation. And furthermore, how the marriage is a revelation of God's holiness, because the marriage of Jesus Christ to humanity is a symbol, or not more than just a symbol, it's an outworking of the principle of obedience and faith, which of course we have come to learn as the principle of holiness. And that's why I suppose unwittingly folk call marriage holy wedlock, because in truth that's what it's designed to be. Now, the first reasonable advance for the necessity for Christ marrying humanity was that otherwise he could never have died for the human family. The simple principle is this, that sin always comes first and death comes by sin. Let's turn, for instance, to Romans the 5th chapter again, Romans chapter 5, wherein Paul lays down this principle in very, very clear and plain terms. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. And here the inspired apostle writes, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world." And who is that one man, obviously? Adam. Now what follows? "And death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." Now death passed upon all men by virtue of the fact that Adam, back in the Garden of Eden, turned aside from righteousness. He let sin become a part of himself and the dominating rulership of this world. And when sin came in, death came in by sin. So first of all, there's sin, and then there's death. And where there's no sin, there can be no death. That's an impossibility. Now, of course, people may then raise the question, all right then, that's very simple logic and very clear logic and very truthful too. So this means then that if a person puts away all sin from his life, then surely he doesn't have to die. But the facts are, it is impossible for us to put away sinful human flesh and blood. That can't be done. And furthermore, your body and my body, your bodies and my body belong to the broken law, and the broken law is going to have what belongs to it, and therefore this flesh and blood body must pass away. The flesh and blood body which you now possess is mortal, it is sinful, it belongs to the broken law, it is condemned to die, and die it shall. Because Jesus Christ did not come into this world to modify or improve or make over our fallen sinful flesh and blood bodies. He came to give us a new body altogether in the place of the old one. A new heavens and a new earth takes the place of the old heavens and the old earth. A new spiritual nature replaces the old evil spiritual nature, and a new body replaces the old body. So that even if you're translated when Jesus Christ appears again, you don't take this body with you, but in a twinkling of an eye, the old body passes away and is so instantly replaced by a new one that you don't even realize the transition. When incorruption puts on corruption, and immortality puts on takes over from mortality. So that the simple facts are that therefore that where sin is, there death reigns, and where there's no sin, of course, there is no death. Now, if Jesus Christ had not taken sinful, mortal flesh and blood, then could that flesh and blood have died? In other words, if he had sinless, immortal flesh and blood, could that flesh and blood have died? Impossible. Now, when Jesus died upon Calvary's cross, it was the sinful nature that died, not the sinless nature. Now, I'd like to read a statement confirming this from the back of volume 7a, it's actually page 446 in this volume. The statement also comes from the Bible Commentary volume 5, page 1113. And I'm reading it from the notes that come from the book Questions on Doctrine, and this is of course a Spirit of Prophecy statement. Perhaps if I go back to volume 5, page 1113, I might give you the original reference, which I think was a Review and Herald statement. There's one thing I appreciate about the Review and Herald statements, and that is that we do have them today in facsimile form, which means, of course, that we're able to have something very genuine and very very authentic. But this is not a Review and Herald statement. It comes from a manuscript, number 131, written back in 1897. And the statement says, "When the voice of the angel was heard saying, 'Thy Father calls thee,' he who had said, 'I lay down my life that I might take it again, destroy this temple, and 3 days I'll raise it up,' came forth from the grave to life that was in himself." Now that he came forth from the grave to life that was in himself. Deity did not die. Humanity died. But Christ now proclaims over the rent sepulchre of Joseph, "I am the resurrection and the life." In his divinity, Christ possessed the power to break the bonds of death. He declares that he had life in himself to quicken whom he would. Now, a little further down, and this statement is a youth instructor statement from August 4, 1898, still on page 1113 of volume 5. I now read these words, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who had said, 'I lay down my life, I might take it again,' came forth from the grave to life that was in himself. Humanity died, divinity did not die. In his divinity, Christ possessed the power to break the bonds of death. He declares that he has life in himself to quicken whom he will." Now, none of these statements are exactly what's on the other page, which seems a little strange. I'll go back to the other one because I like it very, very much. It's even more powerful, I think, than what I just read in those two statements that we've just looked at. Now I go back to page 650 or page 446 in the Bible Commentary Volume 7a, was the human nature of the Son of Mary changed into the divine nature of the Son of God? No. The two natures were mysteriously blended in one person, the man Christ Jesus. In him dwelt all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. When Christ was crucified, it was his human nature that died. Deity did not sink and die. That would have been impossible, right? So Jesus Christ had two natures. On the one side, of course, he has human nature. And that was, if we just make a little list of what it was, number one, it was mortal. Or perhaps I should say, first of all, it was sinful. Number two, it was mortal. And of course, it was very, very much a human nature. Now, on the other side, Christ had a divine nature, which is also called deity. So he was divinity or the divine nature. And that nature was sinless and therefore immortal. And of course, this was holy. I might go back and label this other one over here as being unholy, although that is just simply another way of saying sinful, isn't it? Unholy is sinful. Now, when Christ came to the cross, we're plainly told that humanity died, divinity could not die. Now, supposing that this humanity had been, and let's make a change over here now, supposing this humanity had been sinless and therefore immortal, then could that humanity have died?
No.
Impossible. Absolutely impossible. So that on the cross of Calvary, that which died was sinful, mortal humanity. As Sister Wright says, deity did not die, that would have been impossible. Now this means then that in order for Jesus Christ to die on Calvary's cross, he had to come down to this earth and marry into that kind of flesh and blood which could die. And without that, then without that marriage, then Christ most certainly could not have perished for fallen humanity, because that a sinless humanity could not possibly have died. Now this shows then, in a very real sense, of course, that the Roman Catholic Church today, and right down to its history for that matter, teaches a cross-less gospel. Now true, of course, they talk about the crucifixion, they paint pictures of the crucifixion and the sacrificing Christ, they put crosses on their churches, they wear crucifix around their necks. And if you were to say to a Roman Catholic today that their doctrine denies the crucifixion, makes it impossible for Christ to die, they would scoff at that charge, wouldn't they? They'd scoff at it. But the fact is that Babylon, of course, has two tongues. With one tongue, she makes grand professions of believing in the truth and acknowledges the historical fact that Jesus Christ did die. She eulogizes that death, but by virtue of the fact that the Roman Catholic Church teaches that Christ came in sinless and therefore holy flesh and therefore immortal flesh, that doctrine which predominates so heavily in Roman Catholic teaching makes the death of Christ an impossibility. Therefore it's a cross-less gospel in which there's no saving power whatsoever, none at all. Now if you carry this a little further, of course, you'll recognize that the Seventh-day Adventist Church today likewise declares, together with the Protestant churches, that Christ came in sinless, holy flesh and blood, and therefore immortal flesh and blood. They don't use the word immortal, but the facts are, of course, that when you have a sinless flesh and blood, you have an immortal flesh and blood. The two go together. Only where sin has come in is death present, right? So if it's a sinless flesh and blood, it's an immortal flesh and blood. Adam had immortal flesh and blood until that point of time when he sinned. And the moment he sinned, of course, then he had mortal flesh and blood. So as we have demonstrated in the book, The Destiny of the Movements, showing the plain statements taught by Frum and other Adventist leaders that modern Adventism teaches that Christ came in sinless flesh and blood, then as surely as the Adventist Church teaches that, they do not have any right to teach that Christ ever died upon the cross. Right? In other words, theirs is also a cross-less gospel. And that's why, of course, we're told to come out of her, my people, when we find the church teaching that very thing. Now, just a brief word in regard to this. In the Roman Catholic teaching, of course, Mary is given an Immaculate Conception. Here is Mary, the mother of Jesus, and her conception was supposedly immaculate. Now, the Roman Catholic Church gives Mary that special kind of flesh and blood, and they tell us that she was exempt. She was the only person who was ever exempt from the birth that all the rest of us have. And they give that to her in order to give Jesus Christ the same flesh and blood as she had, so that Christ likewise has an immaculate flesh and blood, holy flesh and blood, sinless flesh and blood, and therefore immortal flesh and blood. And of course, the Roman Catholic Church certainly teaches Mary is in heaven today. That's their teaching. Now, in the Protestant churches, they don't go by this circuitous route. They go directly to Jesus Christ, and they give Christ directly an immaculate flesh and blood conception and therefore birth. So whereas the Roman Catholic Church goes through Mary to Christ, and they give Mary the Immaculate Conception in order to give Christ the same thing, the Protestant and Adventist churches give this to Christ directly without going through Mary first, right? But the end result is what? The same. Right, the end result is absolutely the same. Now, of course, we absolutely believe that Jesus Christ came in form, sinful flesh and blood. We believe that there is a marriage of divinity and humanity, that he was God and he was Christ. And then he was man, in this case, of course, through the body of Mary. That Mary, the mother of Jesus, had a flesh and blood exactly the same as any other human being has got. No difference whatsoever. And therefore, when Mary gave to Christ of her nature, Christ received from humanity through her in this marriage of divinity and humanity, Christ received human flesh and blood, fallen, sinful human flesh and blood, as that flesh was then and as that flesh is today. And how anyone could disbelieve that in view of the plain statements of the book of Hebrews, I shall never know. For instance, if we turn to Hebrews, the second chapter, which chapter, of course, deals with the humanity of Jesus Christ, we find statement after statement which in a most solemn and direct manner testify that Jesus Christ came in the same flesh and blood as the children. For instance, let's look at verse 11, which says that for both he that sanctifieth, and who is the sanctifier? God through Jesus Christ. It's actually Christ specifically is being spoken about, not God the Father really. And they who are sanctified. Who are they who are sanctified? Right, the born again Christian. They are all of one. Now, if you happen to have a revised standard version, for instance, you'll find that it says all of one origin, which I think enlarges the meaning considerably. Makes the meaning much plainer. What translation have you got there, Jackie?
I've got the New King James Version.
What was it saying? Just all of one?
That's verse 11.
Yeah.
For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all one. All of one.
Yeah. Okay, well, the Revised Standard Version definitely says all of one origin, or one source, and that I appreciate very much. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Now, we know our origin as born-again Christians. We're born of God and we're born of man. And from the human side, we get all that humanity has. And the divine side, we get all the divinity has. So we're fully human beings on one side, sinful, mortal, and corruptible. On the other side, we're sinless, holy, and immortal. Now, down to verse 14, which says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood. Now, it says children. Now, if children, there was a father. And who was the father? Adam, right? Okay, now Adam had two phases to his life. There was a sinless phase and the sinful phase, right? But what about the children? Do they have a sinless and then a sinful phase, or do we only have a sinful phase? Right, sinful. So then, for as much then as the children, and that means fallen, sinful, mortal children, are partakers of flesh and blood. There was the only kind of flesh and blood that's ever been known to the children of Adam. The only kind. Sinful, right? Now, just build yourself, well, I build myself, and as we consider ourselves, what conviction fixes upon us so far as our flesh and blood is concerned? Do you feel immortal, sinless, and holy? It's a joke, isn't it? So we know by direct personal experience, not by distant information, but by direct personal experience, what kind of flesh and blood the children have. Now the scripture goes on to say, he also himself likewise took part of the same what? As who? As the children. So when we put in the understood words, which of course are dropped out for brevity and because obvious what it says, we read the text as follows: forasmuch then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same flesh and blood as the children. Is that the message of this verse? Yeah. Absolutely. That he might destroy him which had the power of death, that is the devil. And why did Jesus Christ have that flesh and blood? That he might destroy the devil. And of course, the various reasons, all five or six of them, for Christ taking sinful fallen flesh and blood, were all designed to destroy the devil and to reinstate the glorious kingdom of God. Now verse 16, for verily, now that word verily means for certainly, positively, definitely, he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. So we all know that what the seed of Abraham was, don't we? It certainly wasn't sinless, holy and perfect, but it was sinful, fallen and therefore mortal. And so verse 17 there caps it all off by saying, wherefore in all things, how many things? Right. It behoved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation with the sins of the people. From that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. In the light of scriptures like that, how could anyone ever doubt what kind of nature Christ had when he came to this earth on the physical side? How could we doubt it? Could you ask for plainer scriptures? You couldn't, could you? In the most emphatic way possible, in the clearest way that it could be written, Paul has spelled out the fact that Jesus Christ took the same flesh and blood as the children. He took on him the seed of Abraham. He was made in all things like unto his brethren. And this marriage between divinity and humanity was that he might destroy the works of the devil, which of course is death and, or sin and death. Both of those things are the works of Satan day by day in the lives of human beings. So then the first reason that we can list for the necessity, the sheer necessity of marriage between Christ and humanity was that he might die and thereby pay the penalty on Calvary's cross. So let's now start to make a list of these four or five different elements. I don't plan to study each one in great depth and detail, but mainly to list them with the cardinal points that are concerned with each one. So number one then, the first reason was that he might die, or that he might be a sacrifice for fallen humanity. Now, a second reason we shall give is that Christ had to come down to this earth and make of none effect Satan's lie that the law of God was a yoke of bondage and could not be obeyed by fallen, sinful humanity. Of course, we have spoken on this subject before, so I'll just take up the main points again this morning rather than deal with this in depth and detail. But I do want to review these points quickly so we can appreciate why it was that Christ went to Cana to a marriage feast to begin his ministry and to perform his first very, very wonderful miracle. And to demonstrate, of course, that what Christ was doing there was a very beautiful exemplification of principles of holiness, which are obedience, of course, and faith, as is seen over and over again during the week. I begin by turning to the great controversy, to read a statement in regard to the fact that Satan makes the charge that the law of God cannot be kept, that is his favorite charge against that holy law, because he maintains that it is a terrible yoke of bondage, and that we should not have any ideas about keeping it. That's an impossibility. By page 489, Great Controversy, the last main paragraph on the page, if you have the book, page 489. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Proverbs 28 and verse 13. If those who hide and excuse their faults could see how Satan exalts over them, how he taunts Christ and holy angels with their course, they would make haste to confess their sins and put them away. Through defects in the character, Satan works to gain control of the whole mind, and he knows that if these defects are cherished, he will succeed. Therefore, he is constantly seeking to deceive the followers of Christ with his fatal sophistry that it is impossible for them to overcome. Now, it's worth our while to examine the statement in detail because it's very, very comprehensive. Satan, it says, is constantly seeking to deceive the followers of Christ. Now, what does the word constantly mean? It means all the time, unremittingly. He never lets up. He's always at this wretched business. He sleeps not by day and by night. And this constant attention is directed to what class of people? The followers of? By the followers of Christ. And that is, of course, you and I. So he is continually seeking to deceive people such as you and I with his fatal sophistry that it is impossible for us to overcome. Now, a sophistry, of course, is a teaching that is very subtle, is very clever, is very convincing. It apparently is the truth, but is in fact error. It's something we tend to accept as truth without realizing what we're doing. That's a sophistry. Now, a fatal sophistry is one which ends in what?
Death.
And what kind of death in this case?
Eternal
death. Now, what is this fatal sophistry which ends in death? The argument that it is impossible for us to overcome, impossible for us to live a holy life. Turn back to Desire of Ages page, I think about page 24, and we'll find a further statement there along these same lines. And this deals likewise with the efforts of Satan to prove that the law of God cannot be kept. 24 is correct, Desire of Ages. Satan represents God's law of love as a law of selfishness. He declares that it is impossible for us to obey its precepts. The fall of our first parents with all the woe that has resulted, he charges upon the Creator, leading men to look upon God as the author of sin and suffering and death. Jesus was to unveil this deception, right? As one of us, he was to give an example of obedience. For this, he took upon himself our nature and passed through our experiences. In all things it behoved him to be made like unto his brethren. If we had anything to bear, if we had to bear anything which Jesus did not endure, then upon this point, Satan would represent the power of God as insufficient for us. Therefore, Jesus was in all points tempted like as we are. He endured every trial to which we are subject, and he exercised in his own behalf no power that is not freely offered to us. As man, he met temptation and overcame in the strength given him from God. He says, I delight to do thy will, O my God, yea, thy law is within my heart. As he went about doing good and healing all who were afflicted by Satan, he made plain to men the character of God's law and the nature of his service. His life testifies that it is possible for us also to obey the law of God. His life testifies to that. Now, what a comprehensive paragraph this is. How effectively it states the charge of Satan, the work of Christ in answering that charge, and the fact that in order to answer that charge, Jesus Christ had to come down and possess the same nature as you and I have got. Let's pick out those headlines as we just went over the paragraph quickly again. First of all, the second sentence says that Satan declares that it is impossible for us to obey its precepts. Now there's Satan's charge, right? Now Christ's work. little further down, Jesus was to unveil this deception. That was his mission, to unveil this deception. How would he do it? As one of us is to give an example of obedience. In other words, by coming down and living where we have to live, Jesus was to give an example of obedience. And to do this, he must have our nature, or marry humanity and divinity. So the next sentence says, for this he took upon himself our nature and passed to our experiences. And what a beautiful paragraph. It just sums it up point after point. And then the next most of the next part of the paragraph then talks about the fact that Jesus Christ met temptation as a man. He exercised no power which we cannot have. And the last sentence says, his life testifies that it is possible for us also to obey the law of God. Right? His life testifies to that. Now, let's put the second point down then. An example of obedience. Now, if Jesus Christ had come in any other flesh but ours, instead of being an example of obedience, he would have been an excuse for disobedience. Because we could say, well, that was all very well for Christ to be obedient in that other perfect flesh and blood. And the fact that he was not prepared to come down and do it in my flesh and blood is clear proof that it can't be done in my flesh and blood. Otherwise, he would have done it in my flesh and blood. So if Christ had come in any other flesh and blood, then his life would have been an excuse for sin. In fact, more than just an excuse, a confirmation that sin is the only way of life for a human being. Rather than an example of obedience, it would have been an example of disobedience. And of course, we understand the principle that Satan charges, that he admits, of course, the law can be kept under certain limited circumstances. That was the point he made back in the days of Job, when God said to him, have you considered my servant Job a perfect and an upright man? And Satan says, does Job fear God for nothing? He serves you all right in that context. But taking him out of that context and put him in the world of suffering and misery and so forth, and then he'll curse you to your face. Now Satan could say this with a fair hope of success and with fair confidence, because over and over again he had seen how God's people are so quick to revolt when they are subjected to any kind of disciplinary training. Of course, Job was a man who lived back in Moses' time somewhere, and no doubt before the Israelites began their journey to the Promised Land. Maybe they had begun their journey by that point of time. But remember that and it's well worth remembering that every time that any kind of hardship or suffering came to the Jews, how quick they were to revolt and react with murmuring and impatience and so forth against the chastening of God. How quick they were to do that. And the Lord never had any chance to educate them, because they would always reject the educational influences, wouldn't they? Yes. Right, as soon as God began to put them through a training school, they would jump up and down and say, no, we don't want that. We want lots of food, lots of flesh, lots of water, lots of comfort, lots of ease. Give us those things and we'll be happy. And so God never could educate them. And we have to learn that if we're going to aspire to the heights of righteousness and receive a truly divine education, we have to endure hardness as good soldiers. Now, you study, for instance, the methods used by the army to produce especially a special elite corps of men. The British, for instance, have a very special squad of men who are trained to deal with terrorism and all those very difficult kinds of situations where hostages are involved. And those men go through a training that's so rigorous you wouldn't believe it. And they really suffer in that training. They have to march until their lungs are bursting and their legs are aching and their heart is pounding and their head swims and so forth. And it's that intensive training, that extreme hardship, which brings out men of steel that can really handle big problems. And if we want to be powerful Christians, then we have to learn to endure hardness as good soldiers and recognize that this is but the training process preparing us for larger responsibilities later. Now, of course, those men who join those special squads, and after being a tremendous sifting of candidates, they finally select the very, very best. Now, those men intellectually accept the training, knowing that it's necessary for them to emerge as good soldiers. And so there's no conflict between mind and body in their training program. But there was with the Israelites a tremendous problem in that respect. So Satan then was quite confident that Job would crack, as did the Israelites, at about the same time. But Job proved to be a different kind of man altogether. He was a man that obeyed God in the good times and in the bad times, in sickness as well as in health, in the face of death as well as in life. Thus proving, of course, the lie to Satan's charge that obedience is possible only under limited conditions. Mind you, he had to advance that kind of argument to justify his own faithful service to God over those many, many millennia of time before he finally sinned. God could say to him, well, okay, Satan, how come then that you served me faithfully for those billions of years before you finally sinned? And Satan would answer back, because in that context I didn't know your real character. I hadn't seen you yet to be a liar and a deceiver and a despot that you are. That's how Satan charged God. Of course, we don't charge him with those things, fortunately. And so then, the charge of limited obedience or obedience in a limited context was met by Job and met by Jesus Christ, and it is proved that no matter what the circumstances may be, any one of us from our babies up can live as perfect a life as Jesus did. As of course we saw yesterday in the various pressures brought upon the boy Jesus, just a little fellow, pressurized by the rabbis, by his parents, by his brothers, and by the Pharisees, and by some of the other people, as a child, a helpless little boy, and yet he stood firm as a rock and never by even a thought consented to Satan and his temptations. Now, of course, the subject of Christ's incarnation is so large, we could certainly spend the entire camp period on that, no trouble at all. And some of you remember, of course, that quite a number of years ago, we did do just that. It's well back now, about 1972 or 3, when the book first came out, written by Froome, entitled The Movement of Destiny. And virtually the whole camp was devoted to studying out the various aspects of the incarnation of Christ. But for now, in this very brief revision, we see that Christ had to marry into humanity in order to give an example of obedience. Because if he had not come into our flesh and blood, then Satan would have said, aha, so God is not prepared to let his son come all the way down into the same flesh and blood as these people, because God knows perfectly well that in that flesh and blood it is impossible to obey God's commandments. If he come in the flesh of Adam before the fall, as the Adventist Church teaches, or in the flesh of angels, as he might have come and dwelt among men in that form visibly, then he would have proved, of course, that angels and Adam could have kept the law of God. What would he have proved so far as we're concerned? Nothing whatsoever. And worse than that, as I said before, we could then argue, all right, if he could not do it at this level, then we can't do it either. If he would not, then we cannot. And therefore, there's no use in our trying to be righteous at this level. We might just well abandon ourselves to sin. And if we're going to be saved, God will have to devise some other way than by making us to be righteous people. Right then, now let's move on to our third reason. And the third reason was, or is, that he might give us his life. Perhaps I should, before I do that one, we should put this other one down, that is, reveal the character of God. We'll wait to have the third one. And we'll come on to, because that is very much like the example of obedience, and they sort of go together. So Christ came down to reveal God's character as that character actually is. Now, I know you've all read the book Behold Your God, but after having read that book, people seem to still miss a very, very vital point in regard to this. Because when you find yourself confronted by an unbelieving mind out there in the world, or in the Adventist Church, or which is the world anyway, and people say, yes, okay, but you can't get away from the fact that in the Old Testament it plainly says, and God sent the flood, God sent fiery serpents, God told the Israelites to go out there and wipe out the heathen. He said, take your swords and kill them, every one of them. Don't leave them alive. Kill the babies in arms, kill the pretty girls, kill the nice young boys, slaughter the men, wipe out the women. Don't just kill the soldiers, kill everybody. Burn their cities to the ground, go out there and have a rampage of destruction. And of course, the way the world looks at that picture, it looks like a very convincing picture, doesn't it? Very convincing. And so this morning, I think I would do well to just express in as concise a manner as possible the way to understand the Old Testament and the way to meet the arguments that people hurl at you in regard to the Old Testament. Because obviously, each one of us is appointed to be a defender of God's character, a revelator of God's character, and a manifestation of God's character. Now, when, first of all, even though folk think that they've got an open and shut case in regard to God's character, based on the revelation of the Old Testament, if they take the stand that God was the destroyer who personally wiped out his enemies, then they're faced with some dreadful contradictions and inconsistencies. For instance, when Jesus Christ came to this earth, he said, "I am the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life." I'll take the middle one mainly. He says, "I am the truth." Okay? Now, he who is the truth, he doesn't just speak the truth, but he is the truth. I'd like to confirm that in the book Education this morning, because this statement is very powerful in regard to the life of Christ. It comes on page 78 and page 79. And the statement says, in regard to Jesus Christ, what he taught, he lived. "I have given you an example," he said to his disciples, "that you should do as I have done. I have kept my Father's commandments." John 13 verse 15 and 15 verse 10. Thus in his life, Christ's words had perfect illustration and support. And more than this, what he taught, he was. Right? What he taught, he was. His words were the expression not only of his own life experience, but of his own character. Not only did he teach the truth, but he was the truth. It was this that gave his teaching power. So when Jesus Christ, he did not say in John the 14th chapter, I think it is, he didn't say, "I speak the truth," which was quite true too, because he did speak the truth, but he says, "I am the truth," right? "I am the truth." Now, as the truth, Jesus Christ said to his followers in John the 14th chapter, he says, "If you've seen me, you have seen the Father. I and my Father are one." And of course, as Paul says in Hebrews, the first chapter, verses 1 to 3, that Jesus Christ is the express image of the Father. And back in John the 5th chapter, he there says that whatsoever he sees the Father do, that he does himself. He does nothing of himself. And John the 1st chapter tells us that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now the Word of God is the expression of God. The Word you speak, of course, is the expression of your thought, of your character, of your principles, and so forth. And so likewise, when Jesus Christ came to this earth as the Word of God, he came here to reveal God as God is. Now, the point is, of course, that the revelation of God as given by Jesus Christ is in direct contradiction to the revelation of God in the Old Testament as people understand that revelation. Right? Let me say again. There's no contradiction between the revelation given by Christ in the New and the old. The contradiction comes in how people see the life of Christ in the New Testament, how they see the life of Christ in the Old Testament. And there's the end of the study period. So we'll pick up this theme when we come back together again in a few minutes for our next study period. Our time is gone now for this one. That was 45 minutes, I promise you. I didn't cheat you. Okay, John 1, 1 to 3, Christ was the Word of God. And John chapter 14 is the statement where Jesus said, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." Round about verses 7 down to about verse 11. And John the 5th chapter, verses 19 in particular, and verse 30.
From where?
Paul.
Yes.
Paul
Hebrews 1. Yes, Hebrews 1, 1 to 3. that he was the express image of his Father. Verse now 5 to 11, let's come back at 10 past for our next study period, shall we?
Hebrews 1
Yeah, Hebrews 1 under 3.